John Walsh will be assisting us as we discuss the increasingly disturbing social trends in the United States. John has a Bachelor's of Science in English and Psychology, a Master's in English, and has taught public school for over 30 years. For the past 10 years, he has been a professor of English at Northampton Community College, Pennsylvania. In addition, John was the editor of Band of the White Rose iPad magazine and is currently working on an adventure novel set in Afghanistan. Welcome, Professor Walsh.
Hey, great to be here, guys.
Hey, John, how are you? Good to have you with us. We're going to read some important statistics. I think this will be the basis of the show, so I'm going to follow with these statistics.
Statistics, John. Everybody out there is listening. I read these this morning, and it was pretty stunning. Although I know what's going on, to see the statistics from so many sources was really an amazing, eye-opening experience. Go ahead, Dan.
All right. Number one, a new Washington Post poll has found that a whopping 78% of Americans are dissatisfied, quote, with the way this country's political system is working, unquote. Number two, that same poll found that only 26% of Americans believe that the federal government can solve the economic problems that we are now facing. Number three, Gallup says that Barack Obama's job approval rating has hit an all-time low of 39%. Number four, according to a recent CBS New York Times poll, Congress has a disapproval rating of 82%. Number five, Rasmussen, 85% of Americans believe that members of Congress, quote, are more interested in helping their own careers than in helping other people. Six, that same survey found that 46% of the American people believe that most members of Congress are corrupt. That figure was a new all-time high. Number seven, according to a different Rasmussen survey, only 17% of Americans now believe that the U.S. government has the consent of the governed. Eight.
What was that? Say that one again, Dan.
Well, that I saw that last week in the newspaper, and that
right.
That made quite a stir when
it was published. Yeah, repeat that one.
Only 17% of Americans now believe that the U.S. government has the consent of the government. That's a frightening statistic.
Of the governed.
Of the right. The
of the people.
The social contract looks like it's shredding there. Number eight, a Reuters Ipsos poll discovered that 73% of the American people believe the nation is, quote, on the wrong track. Number nine, Rasmussen, 68% of Americans believe we're actually in a recession right now. A recession, huh? 10, Gallup, percentage of Americans that lack confidence in U.S. banks is now at an all-time high of 36%. 11, U.S. consumer confidence, lowest level in 30 years. 12, Washington Post, ABC News, 90% of Americans believe that the economy is performing poorly. And 13, 80% of Americans in that same poll believe that it is, quote, difficult to find a job these days, unquote. 14, 39% of Americans believe the U.S. economy has now entered a permanent decline. And 15, 48% of Americans believe it is likely another Great Depression will begin within the next 12 months. And finally, number 16, according to a brand new Rasmussen survey, 48% of Americans believe that reductions in government spending are, quote, at least somewhat likely, unquote, to result in civil unrest inside the United States. Civil unrest. So there you have it. That's the background to what our program is today, about the similar conditions that occurred during the Weimar Republic that led to the ascension of Hitler. Billy?
Yeah, no, it's just, like I said, I've read that, and to hear it again, somebody else is reading it is amazing. John, what do you think?
I think it's pretty frightening. That's very much what happened to Weimar. You know, the Constitution for Weimar was ratified in 1919, and the civil servants and the army and the industrial cartels and the universities and judiciary, they all had to take some sort of oath to support the Constitution, but in fact, they pretty much ignored it. The political press was opposed to the Republic, the army, at least the general staff, and the industrialists were opposed to the Republic. They didn't want it. They were used to Kaiser Wilhelm II, a monarchy, and if anything, they wanted that back again because they could keep their positions and The Republic was just a bad idea to them. So they fought it all the way.
So what were the implications of them not going along with the... obviously, it was established anyway.
Well, the implications were that they stood in the way. For example, by 1923, the German mark was worthless. And there was a movement among some politicians to simply balance the budget, which would have halted the rampant inflation, which was making the mark virtually worthless. But they couldn't come to a consensus, and behind the scenes, the industrialists, the landlords, the general staff gouted the government to let the mark's value fall. The reason being that if the mark fell to virtually nothing, which it did, then the public debts and the war reparations that they were supposed to be paying couldn't be paid. So that the war debts were wiped out because the mark was worthless. The general population didn't realize how much the tycoons, the army, and the state benefited by letting the mark fall. But they had to blame somebody because all they saw was their own personal misery, and who can blame them?
So did they blame the Republic? Did they blame the Tea Party by any chance?
Yeah. Well, see, the comparisons are there. That's the frightening part about it. The Tea Party and others who say, look, balance the budget, that will stop the inflation. But, of course, we're told, well, there isn't any inflation. And balancing the budget is a bad idea. We've got to spend more. This is crazy. Crazy.
So, John, just to very briefly step back, Band of the White Rose, explain that, since that's the name of your iPad magazine.
Right. The Band of the White Rose magazine, we started a year ago, and the idea was to, first of all, take up the cause that the White Rose Group in Germany took up. Back 1943, in the winter of 1943, some students and a professor and others at the University of Munich saw what was happening. The war was essentially a losing game by this time. There were numerous plots to assassinate Hitler. Stalingrad was getting ready to fall. The Russians were on the move. America was in the war. It was a losing game. And these students and some professors, a number of the students were also in the army, got together and began to publish pamphlets, of course secretly, because everything was watched by the Gestapo. You couldn't buy a printing press without having it registered with the government. You couldn't buy copy paper without having it registered with the government. So they had to do this very surreptitiously, and then they would spread them around, give them to their friends, and they'd get on trains and hide them in briefcases and take them to Hamburg and Strasbourg and so on around the country. And they were quite vocal in what they wrote. They called Hitler exactly what he was. He was evil. He was demonic. And the White Rose was a symbol for them of what they saw as the purity of what could be and what had been lost to the Nazis and particularly to Hitler's rule in the Third Reich.
So that movement was an inspiration to you then for what you're editing now, correct?
Right, that's exactly right. We try to be eclectic in our interests, but the idea is people are going to look for something if they're not now. They're going to want some beauty in their life. They're going to want something positive in their life. But first, you have to face the facts of what we're surrounded by, of what's happening to us, and, in my opinion, stand up for it and take a look around. Take a bigger look at the picture than just yourself. The blame game is classic. I mean, Hitler was past master at the blame game. It was the Bolsheviks' fault. It was the Marxists' fault. It was the Jews' fault. It was the Catholic Church's fault. It was always somebody else's fault. Never accepting responsibility, even in a personal way, he couldn't do it. He just couldn't accept responsibility. And the White Rose group was saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, we're responsible. The people of Germany have to stand up to this.
Okay, so just for telling that truth by means of leaflets, posters, things like that, and other propaganda, the members of the White Rose group were arrested, tried, and guillotined.
Yeah, they were executed. Yeah, most of them were executed, including the real leaders were Hans and Sophie Scholl, young people, students at the university, Christians, and they, you know, they stood up they stood up to the Reich, and yeah, they were arrested, and they had a trial before the People's Court, and executed for treason. Yeah.
Well, the irony that they were the ones who were executed for treason. At some point, weren't these leaflets adopted by the American military and dropped out of airplanes toward the end of the war?
That's right. That's right. It's a single one of the few, let's say, not single, but a shining example of what was, you know, beneath the surface that was trying to come out of Germany at that time. And yes, the American military glommed onto them and tried to encourage people, look, you've got to stand up to this, and encourage people to just take a stand. Unfortunately, not enough did. One of the problems that people faced if they opposed the Nazi regime, especially early on, was that they kept bickering amongst themselves. They didn't unite against the common enemy. You know, the enemy of my enemy is my friend, and they couldn't get past bickering amongst themselves and wouldn't take action until it was way too late.
Okay. So what you're saying is that although most Germans were law-abiding people, in fact, Germany really was the epitome of culture in Europe at that time, and in a very short period of years, they went into total barbarism. And people look back at that as some kind of anomaly, like how could this happen? It could happen anywhere, though. That's the fact.
It's more the rule than the exception.
Exactly. Once you cast off civilization, religion, God, I mean, man becomes the ultimate ruler, the ultimate judge of moral and immoral actions, and you get Hitler. That's what you get. I guess that's the message that the White Rose group. That's the legacy of the White Rose Group, I would think.
John, if you would, take us through, just in big picture format, the progression from after World War I to the establishment of the Weimar Republic. We don't need necessarily the details, more just the bigger understanding of where they were headed and why they developed the way they did, and then once we establish that, we'll get into some of what we see as the
parallels.
The concerning, disconcerting parallels with what we see today.
Well, the difficulties included the economy, of course, but between 1924 and 1930. Germany began to prosper. The Republic began to prosper largely, and here's key, borrowing from investors, particularly American investors in Germany. So things began to turn around. They particularly increased a vast social service system, which was the model of the world, but they borrowed to increase this vast social service system. And then, when the Depression hit, particularly in 1932, small businesses were ignored and collapsed. The parliamentary system broke down. There were split votes. You had each political party had its own special interests, and they just couldn't bring themselves to set them aside and the national interest be damned. And all that while, of course, Hitler and his Nazi party was gradually growing, placing blame on others. Of course, there was a conspiracy of the communists. There was a communist party, and it did get votes in the parliament. You also had the Catholic Center Party. There were four main parties, and they couldn't bring themselves to set things aside and say what would be good for the nation. And because of those special interests, it fell apart. slowly but surely. And one of the things about the Nazis was they loved chaos. Here's Gregor Strasser, who was one of Hitler's right-hand men, and I think I can find a direct quote.
John, when you say the Nazis love chaos, but in a sense it was chaos that they control, correct?
Exactly. He said, whatever served to precipitate the catastrophe, meaning the collapse of Germany, the Republic, was good for us and our German Revolution. It didn't matter to them what the catastrophe was.
John, do you mean
there was one, and they would take advantage of it?
Do you mean that one should never let a crisis go to waste?
I thought that developed in Chicago.
Well, yeah. I mean, that's the thing, because if you keep a heightened sense of emergency, a heightened sense of crisis, and what does that do? That short circuits debate. It short circuits. Democratic deliberation. You got to hurry up. You got to fix this now. The sky will fall if you don't. And so there's no thought, there's no deliberation, and bingo, you have what we have today. You've got, you know, now we have the Council of 12 committee members, and they're going to work on the economy and spending. Oh, okay. And now another senator, a Democrat, I think it's Senator Nelson, yesterday announced, well, let's have another committee, a committee of 12, to work on job creation. And I'm thinking, well, let's have a committee of 12 to work on the designated hitter rule, for Pete's sake. And yeah, you see, yeah, what happens in the end is that parliamentary government breaks down, and so the power, by 1932-33, the political power in the country was gone from the people and their elected representatives, the Reichstag, and it fell into the hands of a few, and I'm going to quote William L. Shirer here, shallow, ambitious men who were around the president. And the president of Germany at the time was Hindenburg. He was 85 years old. He was senile. And Hitler was waiting in the wings.
Right. So the Reichstag is basically parallel to a parliament or a
yes.
Congress, correct?
So under those circumstances, people basically said, well, let's just let him do what he wants. Kind of like some intellectuals in our country or Hollywood types. I remember Woody Allen saying, seriously, he said, we should just let Obama be a dictator. We should just let him do what he wants. I mean, that kind of soft thinking paves the way for people like Hitler to come into power. So
because of this sense of crisis, we have to hurry up. You know, the sky is going to fall. And, you know, and I remember when I first heard too big to fail. Where does that phrase come into a free market capitalist economy? What do you mean too big to fail? If General Motors failed, if it went bankrupt, what would happen? Oh, the sky would fall. No, it wouldn't. Do you know how many industries in this country have risen and fallen? Consider the whaling industry. Consider the railroad industry. They were top of the line at one time. Did the country fall? Did the economy collapse? No. General Motors would have been broken up into several different countries, companies would have been bought out by who knows who, and most of the people, except maybe the top executives, would have had their jobs back again working for another auto company, maybe a new auto company that could design autos that people actually wanted to buy.
Exactly.
No,
exactly.
We have to bail them out.
The way they presented it was if the bankruptcy were to occur, all of the factories, the inventory, the cars in production would overnight turn into dust. The factories
rubbish.
Would disappear. I mean, it was absurd.
It was rubbish. Yeah. Rubbish.
You know, another thing, when you have this this atmosphere of constant crisis, you know, first off, as you said, it throws the culture off balance.
Yep.
People don't know what's going on. But at the same time, the more sinister elements of the elite tend to inculcate their own programs into the culture. You know, I think back, that's when eugenics was transferred from the United States into Germany. And, of course, with German thoroughness, they took eugenics to its logical conclusion. Well, not only should we practice positive eugenics, where we try to have healthy people breed with each other, let's eliminate the unhealthy and those we just don't like. So that's what happens in that background of crisis. Things that people would never agree to get put into practice in a country. Do you see any parallels to that in this situation?
Well, first of all, yeah, you have the race situation. Race was behind the whole eugenics movement in Germany. Racial purity, the Aryan race, the Teutonic myth and Nordic legends and so on. So today we have race constantly being brought in simply because the president happens to be a black man now. Well, you know, okay, that's fine, but I'd really like him to be a good president, a good administrator, not a man with a vision, but just simply a good administrator of the nation. But we have race being brought in, and it may be brought in again, you know, as the election comes closer.
Well, as he constantly reminds us, he's a black man first and an American and a president second and third.
Yeah.
That's the message I get.
And as far as eugenics go, well, there are all kinds of, as you're probably aware and your audience is aware, there's all kinds of experiments going on of changing DNA and getting involved in creating hybrids, not only in terms of plants, but also animals. And this is, it's incredibly dangerous. And also the idea of some sort of super soldier. And you can't leave it up to the government to make this kind of decision without oversight from the people through their elected representatives.
Yeah, it's a frightening thing to think that the eugenics program developed in the United States, and sadly to say, New Jersey was one of the more active states in the eugenics movement, including President Wilson. And, you know, I remember reading a letter from Hitler to American eugenicists saying, "What a wonderful thing you have done. We will carry on your work here in Germany." And boy, he did.
Yes, that's right. Absolutely right. He admired what was done here. Yeah.
John, give us a little insight into the state of the psyche of the German people in the time that the Weimar Republic was coming into existence. Where were they psychologically, as you understand it, that gave rise to this?
Well, of course, they lost the war,
but they were not actually
invaded, which was probably a mistake because it left the army intact and left it, seemingly undefeated in the sense that no troops, foreign troops, marched through Germany or into Berlin with parades and so on. So they never had the sense that they were ultimately defeated by somebody else, but they did feel enslaved by the Versailles Treaty and the war reparations that were supposed to be paid. But remember this, the German people felt superior, and Hitler played upon this, to the Poles, to the Slavs, to the Russians. They resented France, and to the Jews. They felt superior to the Jews. And so all these different people they were surrounded by, and so they began to feel superior to them in the first place. And then, as people have often said, the German people were bred to be obedient, but so are Americans. Many studies have been done, some famous ones have been done, about American citizens, and they're willing to apparently inflict pain on people. You're probably aware of those famous experiments, giving electric shock to people when somebody comes in with a white lab coat and says, "Oh, you gotta turn up the switch higher. They got the question wrong." And most of the people who were pushing that button, they kind of resisted, but the guy with the white lab coat said, "Hey, you got to do it," and so they did. And those who refused to do it, even they refused politely. You know, they didn't get in anybody's face, like the Tea Party guy yesterday allegedly got in Obama's face. Although, you know, look, these people are public servants. Emphasize
right,
words.
Right. It just seemed aggressive relative to how passive we've been.
Exactly right. Yeah. And I suggest that your listeners, next time, if they can afford to go to a restaurant anymore, and a waiter comes up and takes their order, you treat them politely, you expect your order to come, and they put it down, and at the end of the meal, you leave a tip. Okay, that is a servant. That waiter or waitress is a servant. They serve you. These people on the red carpets with the Darth Vader buses made in Canada now, I mean, these are our servants, and they need to be reminded of that instead of being held up as some sort of celebrity. Not that you yell at them or treat them with disrespect, but hey, ask a question and expect an answer, and if you don't get the answer, ask it again. Our journalists, once upon a time, maybe did that. But now, of course, except in alternative media, you're not going to find it. Because I think they're on the game.
Well, interestingly, about the about pushing with the questions and asking a follow-up, I mean, Dan and I have had some experiences recently where there's a real chilling effect on the part of the, let's call them the agents of the government, the police, who are present at most town hall meetings now. I mean, they try to, whatever their motivation is, that's something else. But the effect that they have is that when people start getting more aggressive with the follow-up questions, they push for the people to back off, remain civil, things like that, and people are intimidated. I mean, I've been in that position, and many others have been in that position, where the context is not conducive to keep pushing these guys. They're not responsible. They're not responsive.
Yeah, yet, absolutely.
That the yes. system is gamed in a sense that we can't really press them. And you call them up, they don't answer your calls. You go to Washington, they don't show up. You go to town hall meetings, they don't respond.
Well, I read today that there are no town hall meetings scheduled for the near future. They're just not going to do it anymore. They think the congressmen and representatives think that they have been put upon, too abused. There are no town hall meetings scheduled virtually anywhere.
So it's a coordinated effort.
Well, they're just not going to do it anymore. Why should we put up with these GD voters? That's their attitude. Those voters are causing us trouble. Why let them in the front door? I mean, that's what's going on here. That's the frame of mind we have here. So, John, I think you're right to point out that parallel of the medical experiment. You know, the doctor walks in with the lab coat. He represents learned authority, and he says, turn up the voltage on the victim, and the person obeys. You know, I bet if you ask the person afterward, well, why did you do that, they'd say, I was only following orders.
That's right.
Yeah, where have we heard that?
Exactly. And I would remind, the police and our military that according to the Nuremberg laws, the Nuremberg trials, that's not a defense anymore. No, that's unacceptable. It's an unacceptable defense. And if you're ordered to do something that's against the Constitution, you have a duty, to not only a right, but a duty to say, no, I'm not doing it.
So you're saying...
Unfortunately, we don't see that happening.
We don't. Are you saying, John, that by law, a TSA agent should refuse to grope a citizen at an airport?
I'm saying that if whatever it is that is unconstitutional, they should refuse to do it. Unfortunately, going to this idea of being obedient, we're great. Americans are excellent at standing in lines. We stand in line and we get groped and we go through the radiation machine and we stand in line at the DMV, we stand in line wherever we go, and most of the time we're very quiet, we're very peaceful, we'll stand there for hours and hours, and we've seen, thousands of people standing in line quietly just to try to get, a voucher for rent or something like that.
So you're saying
be beginning to change.
So, John, contrary to the public perception or the perception that many would like us to believe is accurate, Americans aren't this aggressive cowboy kind of group like we've been led to believe. This liberty loving,
free thinking,
independent, free thinking. I mean, you're saying that that's somewhat of an illusion at this point, or maybe it always was.
I think so. Yes, I do. Free thinking. I'm not. How much thinking is really going on? How many people are actually paying attention? I don't want to be gloom and doom, but if we hit the wall, if there's a collapse of the economy, I think an awful lot of people, it's going to hit them like a brick wall. They're going to be stunned, and they're going to be unprepared. And unfortunately, that puts more and more pressure on the rest of us who may actually be paying attention and be prepared. I'd rather be prepared and be wrong than be unprepared and be right.
So I guess what you're saying then is the conditions at the Weimar Republic are such that the culture was so knocked off balance, so overwhelmed with change and chaos that they just welcomed any solution. I mean, that's what history tells us, and that could happen here. There's no reason it couldn't happen here. Why are Americans any better than any other culture?
Well, American exactly. exceptionalism. Don't you read the papers? Sorry, John. Go ahead.
Go ahead, John.
Go ahead. Hitler. He had the Enabling Act. Some people have already compared this Committee of 12 to the Enabling Act. It was March 23rd, 1933. So he had just become chancellor, and here's the actual title of the Enabling Act. Quote, the law for removing the distress of the people and the Reich, or the nation, unquote. I love that, removing the distress of the people and the Reich. And what did this law do? Well, it was only supposed to last for 4 years, right? It had a limit, 4 years, and it gave to the Reich cabinet, in other words, Hitler's cabinet, all chosen by Hitler, the following things. The power of legislation, including the budget, approval of treaties, initiating constitutional amendments, all taken away from the parliament, the representatives of the people, and handed to the cabinet, which ultimately meant Hitler himself, the Führer.
So this cabinet is you're saying, I think, that this cabinet would be analogous to this Committee of 12 that we have today.
The centralization of power, this present administration, Ronald Reagan promised that he would cut the bureaucracy, cut the government down, and he couldn't do it, or he really didn't want to. I don't know. But ever since then, it's simply gotten bigger and bigger, more powerful, more powerful. There are more regulators. I just heard this on Lou Dobbs last night. There are more regulators working for the government than there are employees for McDonald's, Walmart, Boeing, and I think Burger King combined.
Totally.
Here's the thing.
Totally
Hitler, you know, the Nazi Party wanted to control business, so they wanted to regulate business. Okay, so does this administration, and some regulations are needed, but the more that government tries to regulate business, the more business will regulate government.
Okay.
I think that's happened. You have the merger of corporate and government interests. It's called fascism. Gerald Celente said it a year ago, at least.
Right. I believe Mussolini said it should more appropriately be called corporatism.
Mussolini would know exactly what's happening.
He said it should more appropriately be called corporatism, the merger of the government and the corporation.
Crony capitalism. We're here on WNJC 1360 out of Washington Township. This is Repatriot Radio with Billy Baer and Dan Haggerty, and our guest today is Professor John Walsh, who is drawing some very uncomfortable comparisons between the Weimar Republic in Germany and today's situation in America. John, continue.
Well, here's something that I haven't heard much about, and I've done my research, and I think it will be very interesting to your audience. Let's go back to the late 1700s and the French Revolution. During that period of time, there was a mounting interest, particularly in Europe, with the occult. And I don't mean cults, I mean occult, O-C-C-U-L-T, the supernatural. So much so that when Mary Wollstonecraft, Mary Shelley's mother, the woman who wrote Frankenstein, Mary Shelley, her mother went to Paris because she was all excited about the French Revolution. What she saw horrified her. She actually had to dress down so that she wouldn't be accused of being rich and therefore killed. There were just masses of people. The guillotines were hot and hunting, and the supernatural was beneath the surface. If you were an older woman and an older man, particularly looking poor or down in the dumps, you took your life in your hands if you went into the streets of Paris and other cities in France. Why? Because they were willing to blame witchcraft. You would be accused of being a witch or a wizard or a sorcerer. And if you had a hunchback or some other physical deformity, you were dead. You were dead in the streets. Mary Wollstonecraft goes back to England and only writes about this in her letters, what she saw, but she never wrote a book about it. No sense telling the truth. Just stick with the hypocrisy. Now, move forward to just before World War I, the late 1800s. You had Madame Blavatsky and the Theosophy movement. You had Aleister Crowley and his movement, his occult movement in England. It was very popular over here as well, particularly Theosophy. And it was an interest in the occult and the seances and spiritualism, the spiritual tapping, the Fox sisters, the spiritual mediums. And what happened next? You had World War I. Now jump forward to the Jazz Age, when seances really became popular, so much so that Harry Houdini himself went around debunking spiritual mediums while at the same time hoping to be in touch with his dead mother. And now we move into the Great Depression, the Dust Bowl, World War II. Now, take a look at this. Since the 1980s, what do we have up to today? An explosion of an interest in the occult. You have ghost shows, you know, ghost hunting shows, the vampire movies, the werewolf movies, werewolf shows, zombies, witchcraft, Wiccans, sorcery, Harry Potter, and on, the video games involved with sorcery. My point being, I'm not blaming anybody for being an interest in this. Go ahead. But it seems to be, and I say seems to be, a precursor, a premonition, an omen of bad things coming.
Hey John, it's not like the politicians have any organized interest in it, in this type of movement, do they?
Well,
depends on your sources.
Go ahead, hold on. Go ahead, John.
Look, there's the Bohemian Grove in California.
Go ahead, brief explanation.
Yeah, some of the very rich, very powerful celebrities, they go there once a year, and among other things, there is some sort of pagan ceremony. Alice Jones took pictures. He snuck in, took pictures. It's very well guarded, and there's a giant granite owl. I think it's 40 feet tall. And they go through this ceremony where they, it's called the Ceremony of Care. And the idea is to get rid of your conscience. Don't care. They burn it up or something. They have an effigy.
Yes.
And there's people with torches and dressed in robes and so forth. It's really spooky. And I don't know how long it's been going on, but it's been going on for decades. And
it's currently going on.
It's going on as we speak.
Yeah, I'm sure they had a meeting.
In fact, they're meeting right now. I'm just kidding. I don't. Yeah. It might be.
I think it ended last week. But you're right. On InfoWars, which is Alex Jones's channel, they do talk about. It's essentially a pagan feast, which very weird. President Nixon went, and he didn't like it. He got back and said that was the damnedest, faggiest thing I've ever been to. That's what he said. But as you're right. The Bilderbergers show up there. All of the basically New World Order types show
and
up.
And also presidential candidates.
Presidential candidates show up there.
From both parties.
I understand Rick Perry is the darling of the Bilderbergers. That's the talk going on right now. But who knows? Who knows? The fact that we're even talking about things like that gives an indication of what's going on.
So, John, what other parallels do you see between the lead up to Nazi Germany and what we're experiencing today? Specific things, like we touched on the Super Congress or the Super Committee of 12 plus the president. What other examples can you think of how, especially with the psychology? I know you have a background in the psychology. What kind of parallels can you draw between what's going on?
Well, just to add one final point, Hitler and the Nazi movement and Himmler were very into the occult, too. That was something that drove them, and it goes with the whole Aryan race and the Tibetan masters and the Armanin and the Vril. All that stuff, and people can look that up. It's very well documented.
You mean Indiana Jones and the Lost Ark? Indiana Jones and the Lost Ark. That
fiction. That, that kind of covers it very briefly and, you know, in an entertaining sort of way, but they took it seriously. Himmler certainly took it seriously.
Yeah, it was based on truth.
Himmler took it so seriously that when FDR died, he thought that was the miracle that would turn things around in the war, and Joseph Goebbels called him up and said, "I congratulate you, my Führer. Your Roosevelt is dead." This was in 1945. Hitler was in his bunker. It was over, you know, but an astrologer said, "Oh, something miraculous is going to happen." Also, the people of Germany didn't seem to mind that the borrowing, particularly again from American investors, was going on. They didn't seem to mind that, and they wanted to hear the kinds of things that Hitler was telling them as he rose to power. He made these great speeches. He preached free enterprise. He preached an army of the German people to the army. He supported the unions and said that the working man was the backbone of Germany. He was against the money barons. All of this was public, and the people, of course, bought into it. Whereas privately, he met secretly with many of these quote-unquote money barons. Sometimes, so secretly, he would meet in a forest glade far away from reporters who might report that he was hanging out with coal barons, the head of the steel trust, the director of IG Farben, the chemical cartel,
Rockefeller,
anti-rubber interests. So he was saying one thing and then another thing. And, you know, if you ask me, Obama is Mr. Goldman Sachs. I mean, Timothy Geithner came from Goldman Sachs. Larry Summers came from Goldman Sachs. Jeffrey Immelt, the CEO of General Electric, that paid no taxes.
Interesting.
His advisor, one of his chief advisors on the economy and on job creation. Meanwhile, GE is sending jobs overseas as fast as they can, hooked into this green, thing with the climate change.
So, interesting footnote, John. I believe Barack Obama's mother, Stanley Ann Dunham, worked for Timothy Geithner's father. In the banking industry.
Yes, that's right.
See, you learn something new every day.
It's another coincidence, I suppose.
Sure. Jack Cashel has written about some of those connections. John, for a few minutes, again, to the cultural background, something you mentioned reminded me of something. You know, we talk about the leadership of the Third Reich, and, you know, they're usually dismissed as lunatics, but they were anything but. They're very smart people. And I'm thinking of Dr. Joseph Goebbels. Now, Goebbels is portrayed as a nut, but he was the developer of propaganda for the modern age. And one of the things he said was that he's not responsible for saying that if you tell a lie often enough, it's the truth. But what he did say was that if you consider a society to be like an organism and you constantly inject hatred into the organism, you constantly vilify a certain group, it'll eventually turn the entire culture against that group, which is what they did with the Jews. You know, you hear the Tea Party folks being talked about as terrorists. And today in the New York Times, a professor from Notre Dame and another professor, an economist, talked about how the Tea Party, they say, is diverging from the standard American belief system. They're just, you know, out the window, basically, the Tea Party. They're right-wing fundamentalist Christians, and they're out of touch with the rest of society. So you kind of see this very similar injection of hatred into the cultural milieu. Can you comment on that?
Well, yeah, I agree. And it was Goebbels who thought up the Reichstag fire. Before it happened, he said, "That's what we need. We need something like that." Doesn't this sound familiar?
Yeah, explain that, John. Explain
and then
that.
Make up a list.
Explain that incident with the Reichstag fire.
Yeah, make up a list of people to arrest before it even happens, and then have something like the Reichstag fire. We'll blame whoever we want to. We'll arrest whoever we want to because we got the list already, and that's exactly what happened. Now, it may have been that a communist, some dolt, was involved. It's still a little, you know, it's still a little foggy. But nevertheless, the Reichstag fire did burn. The Nazis blamed the communists immediately for everything. It was a vast communist conspiracy. And naturally, because of this terrible threat, there had to be a suspension of civil liberties. That was February 28th. You got to suspend civil liberties.
Exactly.
No more freedom of speech. No more freedom of assembly. You can't have that to protect, remove the distress of the people and the Reich. And, of course, there were supposedly communist documents, put that in quotes, documents, that were going to be published to prove that the communists had a great plot to bring down Germany. Those documents were never published, never produced. Who knows if they ever existed in the first place?
Of course, a false flag operation. Now, that's very interesting.
Exactly.
You mentioned the civil unrest. Just this past weekend in London, of course, you had the riots. And I understand that there's been evidence that the rioters are being paid, some of them, to go out and foment the riots. The police have been ordered to stand down, and let the rioters wreak havoc. And the interpretation of this is that Parliament is about to suspend civil liberties in England. I understand there's a bill working its way through Parliament to make it illegal to assemble in public without a government permit right now in England today. So
Yeah, I have no question that they're going to try to do that. Look, you know, what happened in World War II, particularly to the Jews, can tell us that Europe knows exactly how to lock people away, particularly the continent. They know exactly how to do that. They know exactly how to arrest people on the flimsiest of excuses, or no excuses at all are necessary. Remember, Hitler rose to power entirely legally. He did it legally.
Sure.
Once he was in power, all bets were off.
Sure. Now, you know, another parallel that your discussion is reminding me of is the Citizen Army. The Citizen Army that, you know, you talk about, you remember the Sturmabteilung, the SA, they became so powerful that during the Night of the Long Knives, Hitler eliminated Ernst Röhm, their leader, but then they were transformed into the SS. People don't realize the SS was not a part of the German army. The German army was contemptuous of the SS. The SS was Hitler's private army, and we all know what they did. So when Obama announced that he wanted a citizen army, that sent hackles down the spines of
the powerful and well-funded as the U.S. military.
Exactly, as powerful and well-funded
as
the U.S. military. That's what he said. That should have been a real serious wake-up call for everyone.
Well, that was... I'm looking at a page here. That was my very next topic, the National Service Corps. Or is it corpse? I forget. Good grief. But, yeah, oh, yeah. And you can see it coming because with all the unemployment, which is only going to... I'm sorry. It's only going to go up. And it can be a way to hire people. Oh, sure. And they'll be paid, and they'll be trained, and they'll have uniforms, and there'll be places to report, and stuff like that. It'll be just like a draft, only it'll be for an army within our borders to keep us safe. There's no question about it. And people, I'm sure there'll be a number of people who will go for it, if only to alleviate the unemployment among the young. But yeah, sure. What color shirts will they wear? Will they be brown? Will they be blue? Will they be black? Yeah, and of course the SA, for the most part, at least initially, were made up of thugs, pimps,
right.
Bandits, burglars. They were the lowest, and they were the rough guys, the tough guys who beat up on people.
The kind of people who would stand at a voting booth with a club in their hands and not let you go in to vote.
Yeah, people exactly.
Just hypothetical.
Yeah, good thing we don't have that in this country.
They'll be prosecuted. Sure.
Or in Philadelphia.
John, that brings you up to obviously the next thing that floats around in when you have discussions like these, FEMA camps.
Wait a minute. FEMA used to be a good thing. Now it's a bad thing? Is that what you're saying, Dan?
Well, it's funny. You know, back years ago, FEMA was the Federal Emergency Management Agency who was going to come in and help after an earthquake or a hurricane. And, of course, Hurricane Katrina showed how ineffective the government was at doing that. It was Walmart and groups like that.
Well, somehow the government being ineffective seems encouraging at this point.
Yeah, exactly. Well, back then it was a problem. But now FEMA seems to have transmogrified into something to worry about. And you see on the internet videos of cattle cars, long trains that are brand new, sparkling new, and they look like they're going to be used to transport people. Alex Jones and Jesse Ventura.
Or very fancy cattle.
Or very fancy cattle, right. Alex Jones and Jesse Ventura did a show on FEMA camps, and they told the, I believe it was the Sci-Fi Channel that ran the show, they wanted to redo the show, and they were told they couldn't. They said, you're not going to redo that. That show has caused so much consternation in this country. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be permitted to run it again. So, John, what's your take on FEMA camps and the possibility that the implications of that?
Well, first of all, if people would do what FEMA itself recommends, which is have some bottled water, have some non-perishable food items, candles, and just because of a disaster, extra batteries, flashlights, just do what the government's telling you to do would be a big help for yourself and for everybody else in this country. So FEMA recommends the very things that anybody who's preparing for potentially the worst would recommend. But here's something that in the Rise and Fall, the Third Reich, William L. Shirer, this is a direct quote, he says, dictatorship was accomplished with breathless speed, crudeness, trickery, and brutality. The thing that got me the most was breathless speed. People right now may not see this, and they may be listening and thinking, oh, we're crazy. And we bring up all these different things, and it was so long ago. I can hear it now because I've talked to my friends, and they just don't want to hear it. They're in denial. The thing of it is, it can happen with breathless speed.
John, interesting, just brought to mind, this was under when Bush was president. I remember seeing the video of Brad Sherman, a Democrat congressman from California, getting on the floor of the House and referencing some of his discussions with his colleagues, in which they were briefed by some of the people in the administration. And this was this had to do with the passage of the $800 billion TARP or so. And he said that people were literally told that if they don't pass TARP, there's going to be martial law imposed and there's going to be tanks in the street by Monday morning. This was like on a Friday when this was apparently said.
The congressmen were told this, yeah.
The congressman was on the floor of the House. This is in the congressional record. There's video out all over the place about this. If you Google Brad Sherman, it'll probably pop up. It's just stunning. So that goes along with the idea of the urgency to do something. And typically people, when they're in an urgent, desperate situation, they make bad decisions, and they relinquish their own autonomy.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, that's
exactly
the point. Right. Yeah, that's the point of having the chaos.
Chaos, crisis, a heightened state of emergency. That's what we've been getting since Bush and TARP, and it's continued since then. You got to hurry up. You got to do this now. The sky's going to fall. This will collapse. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
John, we have about 3 minutes. One thing I want you to touch on briefly. You don't need to draw any parallels. We could just let that hang for now. But the psyche of Adolf Hitler, how would you describe that?
Well, he was a narcissist, among other things.
What do you mean by that?
Hitler lied routinely to hide his past, to win sympathy, to foster the image that he desired. He claimed, for example, that he was born and bred in Bavaria. No, he wasn't. He claimed that he was poor. No, he wasn't. He was his family was middle class.
Where was he born?
Austria.
Austria, yeah. To him, the middle class was oppressive and took advantage of the lower class. That's the way he saw things. So he rejected middle-class values, and he personally and publicly identified with the poor and the homeless. The problem with a narcissist is it results in being very easily insulted. They have feelings of inferiority, and so they have that striving to be superior and believing that they are, in fact, superior. And, of course, they always look for scapegoats. They never take responsibility. And Christopher Lash wrote a book years ago, The Culture of Narcissism, and there are other books on the subject now, that we have raised, a generation, a nation of narcissists. It's all about them, and they're entitled. I'd have to tell my students, look, it's not all about you. You don't get an A, you don't get an F. You earn the grade that you are eventually going to get. That's all that happens here.
All right, John, let me ask you. Do you think our president is a narcissist?
Oh, yeah. He's the narcissist in chief. Yes, he is. And because what happens is that just as the German people felt betrayed, felt enslaved, felt superior, felt that they were put down by others, they felt they had this narcissistic sense. And so what did they do? They went with a narcissist, someone who represented them, someone that they could put their psychology onto, their image of themselves onto, and sort of was like a love relationship back and forth.
Well, I kind of heard that yesterday when Obama was talking, and he talked about how all the nasty things people have said about him, portraying himself as a poor victim.
Dan, on that note, we spent the past hour with Professor John Walsh. We discussed the Weimar Republics and parallels with the current situation, and we'll see you next week. Dan and Billy out. Repatriot Radio.
Take care, John.
Thanks
bye-bye,
for having
John.
Me on.
Take it easy, John.